are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everybody, and welcome to week four of the TV version of Art 100. My name is James Scarborough, and this week we're going to do principles of design. But before we get into that, we're going to do a couple of things that we always do. The first thing is, oh, we're live, by the way, and there'll be a phone number and there'll be an email address for you guys to respond to the following questions of the day, and let's take a walk. So if we could see the first question of the day, please. And that question says, how can we use principles of design in our daily lives and creative endeavors? Can being aware of these principles help us make judgments and decisions about our surroundings? Now, the thinking behind that question is, we're talking about principles of design in terms of art, and we're going to look at the various ways that they play out in art. But it's also a very effective way to think about the way that we organize our lives, whether we do it on purpose or not, from how you decide what you're going to wear in the morning or what you're going to wear when you go out at night, how you decorate your bedrooms, what kind of art you have. There's just the way you design things, it's everywhere. So the question is getting you to think about it consciously in the event that you do it unconsciously. And the reason the second part of the question says, can being aware of these principles help you make judgments and decisions about your surroundings, is because, like I said, you know, a lot of us just mindlessly get up. I was asking students in my face-to-face class yesterday this question, and I was asking how they decided to wear whatever it is they were wearing. And one of my students, she was wearing a very, very colorful flannel shirt. And I said, well, that's interesting. Were you trying to make a statement or of some kind? Because, you know, that's one of the reasons people wear what they wear, is to make a statement. And she goes, no, it's because I'm lazy and it's my go-to thing. So she didn't put any design thought into it. She put more of a lack of concerted effort into it. But I'm sure there's reasons why people do things, why we dress and everything, to make a statement, to be invisible, to blend in, to do whatever. So that's what that question is. The second question of the day, please, is kind of like the question we had last week when I asked about color. I could have chosen any of the principles of design, but for this one, I chose visual rhythm, actually for the simple reason it's my favorite. Why do artists create visual rhythm? And for what reasons do they incorporate rhythmical elements in their works? How are viewers influenced or affected by these rhythmic elements? Now, when I say rhythm, we're going to talk about it later, but I'm really interested in what you guys have to say based on what you think rhythm is. Because rhythm is one of those things that you probably have a ton of it without knowing that you have a ton of it, from the way that you talk, from the way that your handwriting, well, nobody handwrites anymore. Well, from the way handwriting used to look, there's rhythm involved in all this stuff. It's involved in dancing, whether it's in a club or, God help us, in front of a mirror in your bedroom. So that's the purpose of that question. It's to take one of these design principles that we are going to be talking about today and just talk about it, you know, how artists apply it. And you can just talk about your answers out of your head. I'm going to try to answer as many as I can, as always. We always, always get an overwhelming number of responses. And if the class was, say, 3 hours long, I could probably get around to all of them. So I'm going to read as many as I can. I'd be delighted if somebody would call. If I don't get to them, as I say, fear not. I will see them tonight, and everybody will get credit for it. Let's look at one more time so that students can see it. Can we just briefly look at the first one again, please? Sorry. Okay, how do you use design in your daily lives? Okay. And what does being aware of it help you do? And then there's the second one. Why do artists create a visual rhythm? Okay, there you go. And the Let's Take a Walk this week is going to be an artist named George Seurat. The piece is called Circus, 1901. This is actually one of my favorite paintings. I actually think it's perfect for this class, for this particular class, because it exhibits all sorts of principles of design. For instance, if you're looking for visual rhythm. And I don't know if you guys have heard the name of George Seurat, and I don't know if you guys have actually seen Ferris Bueller's Day Off, but we talked about this last week, and I just want to remind you that you look at the painting, and I mean, there's shapes. There's the horse and the woman on top, the acrobat jumping off the back, all that stuff. You think, well, it's got line, it's got mass, it's got volume, it's got all that stuff. Actually, if you could do a huge close-up, it's comprised of zillions and jillions of dots of paint. And there's a certain rhythm just in that fact, that technical fact alone, and obsessive rhythm. And as I mentioned last week, in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, our three heroes are at the Art Institute of Chicago. There's a very famous, probably the most famous Seurat painting is there. And it's the afternoon on the Grand Jatte, which is an island off the coast of Paris. And people are having a Sunday afternoon picnic. And it looks just like this painting. But then they get closer to it, and then closer to it. So we're seeing it through the eyes of the camera. And we get to the very front of the canvas, and you can't see what anything is except that it's a bunch of dots. So by this time, by this end of this week, we will have gone through the visual literacy part of this class. Last week we did elements. This week we're doing design principles. A way to think of it is when you talk about visual elements in a work of art, you think about, you know, the color, the shape, the line, the space, all of that stuff. It's static. They're static things. You look at a painting, you go, okay. You look at the same painting, you talk about it in terms of the color, and then you go, okay, what are the lines up to? What are the shapes up to? Everything is seen distinctly. When you start talking about design principles, it's when things come together, whereas the elements of art, the visual elements, are static in this respect. The principles of design are more dynamic. It's more movement in the painting. It's how artists create movement and visual interest. It's how you read the painting. And so what I'd like to see you guys do is, I mean, the Let's Take a Walks are interesting, you know, those of you that write in. They're descriptive. You're talking about the content, and that's fair enough, because that's a perfect place to begin. With what we will have learned by the end of today, at the end of this week, you're going to have a lot of formal vocabulary to talk about the form of these things. And really, I've talked about a couple of walkaways that I want you guys to get out of this class. The biggest one is nothing more than art is accessible if you spend more than 20 seconds looking at it. And the second is a corollary to the first. Namely, you can just look at something. You don't have to know a ton about the artist or anything. You can just look at it. And a very, very good way to do it is to do it by taking the form and then comparing it to the content, or taking the content and then comparing it to the form. So that Syrah piece we just saw, it's a circus piece, so it's going to be lively. There's all sorts of, you know, a circus implies three rings, fun, all sorts of activity happening at the same time. But yeah, you can now talk about it visually. You can talk about line and color. You'll be able to talk about it in terms of rhythm too. So I would really like to see you guys do that again. We have a caller. Hello, caller. What is the caller's name, please? Philip. Philip from Orange. Hello, Philip again. Philip, by the
way. Hello, this is Philip.
Hi. Philip, by the way, has called three times now, and that is absolutely brilliant. And
I use the principles of design in my daily life when I pick out the clothes I wear in the morning.
Okay.
Using Unity by putting certain colors together. When
okay.
I take photographs with my camera, I use balance and emphasis by finding a specific focal point. I recently designed a harmonica case to hold my harmonicas and used scale and proportion so they would fit into the foam slots and symmetrical balance so the slots would look nice. I think being aware of these principles helps us to make judgments and decisions about our surroundings. Even though I didn't know the specific principles of design when I organized my bedroom, I probably used them. I use symmetrical balance when I arranged my shelves. I use emphasis when I hung up some pictures and used Unity by using green throughout my room. Now that I am more aware of the principles, I will be able to use them more when I design other things.
God, Philip, that's brilliant. That's incredibly impressive. Well done. Thank you very much. Philip has clearly read the textbook, and he has made a very cogent, well-organized, well-thought-out response to this. So he clearly, God, you think about your clothes when you get up. But anyway, it's brilliant. That's exactly what it is. It's, you know, when you're aware of it, you probably do a lot more of it than you would otherwise. Very good. Thank you so much. We have an email from Katrina. Hi, Katrina. Response to the first question. We organize our lives around the principles of design. We use color to decorate our homes and to dress. A lot of times people will ask you what your favorite color is when trying to get to know you better. It's true. It's like asking somebody their zodiac sign, too. I mean, you can tell a lot about somebody by the color. And I'm thinking, when you ask somebody their favorite color and they say black, that tells you quite a lot about that person. She's going into the second one. Without rhythm, we would not be able to sing. Well, that's true. That's true. However, I would like to add, Katrina, thanks for writing. I would like to add that there are many of us, i.e. me, that sing like a madman all the time, in the shower, in my car. I might know the lyrics to a million songs. I have no voice, and I absolutely guarantee you I have no rhythm. But point well taken. Thank you. Connor. Thank you, Connor. He writes, visual rhythm, I think, means how your eye is attracted to certain colors and how that makes your eye move around the painting. I think artists have to have it to create depth in their painting. He's actually, without specifically acknowledge, that's well done, thank you. He's acknowledged what is called composition, which we'll talk about later. Composition is nothing more than artists consciously, maybe subconsciously, but definitely a combination of both. They try to get your eyes to do something, to look across the picture, to come in for a close-up, to stand back. Your eyes are doing all sorts of things. And I keep saying this, and it sounds like the most ridiculous platitude, but what you have to keep remembering about art is that it's called the visual arts, okay, the visual. So he's absolutely right. Rhythm is a way that the artist gets our eye to move around the image, as are all the other principles of design, and as we saw last week, as the elements of the visual elements are. Thank you. Isabella, thank you for writing. Question of the day number two. Artists create visual rhythm because it's part of their daily lives. Rhythm is like the balance of a painting, and it's very effective in determining the mood of a painting. It can affect how we perceive symbolism. Exactly, that's exactly what it is. The rhythm, for instance, we just saw that, I keep going back, we just saw that Seurat painting, and the rhythm of it is furious. I mean, the colors and everything else are, but there's a rhythm when you go from shape to shape, you look at the curvy lines, you look at all that stuff. So yeah, rhythm gets us going, and it definitely determines to a great extent the mood of a painting. And rhythm, by the way, rhythm does not have to mean, you know, crazy fast and furious. There can also be a slow rhythm, there can also be a syncopated rhythm, but it's just the beat, like the beat of a painting or of a work of art. Okay, let's go on to, we're gonna get to these, questions, which are fantastic again. What I'd like to do is, I sent you guys a link on Friday to another for fun thing. It's called the, well, let's go to it. Can we see what's on my computer screen right in front of me right now? My monitor, please. We've got that hooked up, yeah. Okay, so I sent you a link, and this is for fun, which means, well, it's for fun, but I set this up. It's kind of tongue-in-cheek, but not really. I mean, artorial is not a word. Electorial is. But I got to thinking, now that we're getting to look at art in terms of the form as well as the content, I took 17 self-portraits by famous artists, famous self-portraits by 17 artists. And what I did is I remembered, I chose 17 because in the first Republican debate in the primary, they had 17 candidates. So the basic question is, it's like a little visual survey. Based on your personal reaction to the work of art's content and form, which artist, via their portrait shown below, would you choose as your next president? So, I mean, some of these you're gonna know. There's Frida Kahlo, there's Van Gogh. I chose not to have him with his ear cut off, just to show you something different. I don't think many of you have heard of Lucian Freud, fantastic British artist, but what might be interesting is he's the grandson of Sigmund Freud. Here's a self-portrait of Picasso. There's Matisse, the guy that paints all the conversation and the piano lesson and everything. Da Vinci, Rembrandt, you guys might know. And then Courbet, who looks like I don't know what. I forgot to ask you to tell you this. You can write in candidates, by the way. So what you do, you look at it, and you just sit there, and again, it's for fun. This is not a profound statement about art. It's a way to get you just to sit there and just look at these things, pick up on the vibe in the piece based on the facial expressions of Frida, you know, the monkey, the foliage, the somber expression, but also the colors, the fact that she's in a narrow space. It's a very narrow painting. There's no depth to it. How do these characteristics affect you? Would you vote for her based on that and nothing else? You don't have to know anything about the artist. I mean, certainly you'd vote for her, maybe, and not for the Gustave Courbet. I don't know, but maybe you have your own particular taste. A bunch of you have done it. I've done it in my other classes already. And then the second part, so you do it, it takes 2 seconds, and then I'm gonna tabulate these things and I can read off the result. And I'm very curious to see how this ends up myself. So you can do it now, for instance. The second part of it, as you can see in that announcement from Friday, is there's a discussion forum as well, a thread, where if you're inclined, I mean, please vote, just vote. It's your inalienable right, even to vote for a president based on their self-portrait, is space to talk about the reasons why. And really, that's what I'm trying to get you to do is, and to get you to do in this class, is to look at something and you go, oh, I like that, or oh, God, that's dreadful. And that's fine, that's easy, that's automatic, you've done it your whole life. But the key thing is to answer the follow-up question, okay, you don't like that, why? So we have a student named Sanam Rafiq, and he responded in the forum, and I love this, and I actually love his choice, but mostly I love it for what he wrote. I chose Lucian Freud as the president to be. Why? Well, that's a great question. And here's the key thing. I know nothing about this man. I didn't even know of his existence until this poll. The portrait persuaded me, though. Now, you'll remember the first question. That's brilliant. The first question of the day that we had in the first class was, can you look at a, no, actually from the first class, is can you look at a work of art and do you have to know anything about the artist or not? And I mean, you can. You know, some of you like to know everything about where they're born, where they studied, who they work with, who they married, et cetera, et cetera. And some of you just prefer to at least begin by just looking at it. Well, Sanam totally captures what I'm trying to do with this for fun forum, this election. I didn't even know of his existence until the poll. The portrait portrayed me, persuaded me enough. That's exactly what it is. By looking at this, by giving it a concerted look, not some quick little glance, he came to this conclusion. In the portrait, he was standing taller than whoever was viewing it. Yeah, that's scale, that's foreshortening. Like he's looking down on you. That didn't matter. It's the fact that it reminded me of a good Charlotte photo shoot. That's a band, I think. It's basically the stance for any musician taking photos, arms crossed, looking confident and down onto the camera. It reminded me of some of my favorite bands. And then he ends, that's brilliant, but he ends with, I should have picked Frida Kahlo. Sanam, if you're there live, can you please call me and tell me why, after this excellent description of why you picked Lucian Freud, you decided you should have chosen Frida Kahlo. And with that, I thank you. Okay, we have three news stories, quick news stories here, and then we'll get into this. Sunday was the 15th anniversary of 9/11, and I'm not going to say anything politically. This is not about any of that stuff. The horror still lives. It's the most awful thing that anybody can imagine. But I read something very interesting. Do we have that image of the 911? So one of the things they found out, and I'm surprised nobody publicized it sooner, they did a test, and this is not to diminish the loss of life. I have to be abundantly clear about that. They figured out that when the towers came down, $110 million worth of art was lost and or destroyed. $100 million of the art was in corporate collections, which makes sense because but the Twin Towers housed all sorts of investment banking firms, especially the firm called Cantor Fitzgerald, which is the saddest story I've ever read. You can look it up and see video. There's a very wonderful documentary on it. They had an astonishing corporate collection. A lot of companies do, big and small. They had Picasso's, they had paintings, Rodin sculptures, all sorts of stuff. $100 million worth out of all of that, not just Cantor Fitzgerald. The $10 million in private art that was destroyed or lost came from people's own collections. So I guess they brought it to work or something. But that's an amazing toll, $110 million. That was the insured value of the work. The next news item is, and I was astonished yesterday. I told this story in my face-to-face class, and I'll just tell you. So it's the 50th anniversary of the TV series Star Trek, 1965. All right? So to commemorate that, the Smithsonian Museum, or Air and Space Museum, got the original Starship Enterprise spaceship, okay? And it's now in the museum. It's part of an exhibition. And that's, you know, interesting, because museums can be anything, as I said in the prompt for the ArtSight paper. But what I found especially interesting was they also have docent tours. A docent tour is simply another name for a docent who talks about the show. Well, so the docent for this particular show is going to give the tours in Klingon. So I said this story yesterday in my face-to-face class, and my students looked back at me, and I said, oh God, what? And I said, how many of you have heard of the Star Trek TV show? I have 45 students in my face-to-face class. Two of them did. So I think I got to find more contemporary references. We're going to skip that Aikens video. There's a really cool show that's opening at the Museum of Contemporary Art by an installation artist named Doug Aikens. It's a 2-minute video. If we have time at the end, we'll see it. But it's just an installation. There's no definition of what an installation is in a gallery or a museum. It can be anything. This is a combination of music and video, and you're sitting right there looking at it unfold around you for 360 degrees. We'll try to get back to that at the end. Last week, as a brief wrap-up, one of the things we talked about was the emotional effects of color. And we looked at a piece by James Abbott McNeil Whistler. By the way, if you've ever heard, there's a very famous painting called Whistler's Mother. Well, he painted it. We're not going to look at that. We're going to look at a piece called Nocturne in Blue and Gold. It's the old Battersea Bridge, and that will be coming up in just a second. And the reason I chose that piece is because the color blue creates a very melancholy, kind of serene image. I couldn't find a good reproduction that shows just how the different shades of blue create to the mood of it. I also chose this because even though the piece was done over 100 years ago, I used to ride my bike. I lived in South London, and I would ride my bike to campus across that bridge. It didn't look like that, but it's the same bridge. The other piece we looked at in terms of the emotional effects of color is The Scream. And we talked about it also as a news item. Well, not this version, because somebody, well, actually it is. Somebody had found what they thought was a bird dropping because he painted outside, but no, it's just wax. But the colors in this are just crazy colors. There's also, I'll give you a little hint of stuff. There's rhythm. Rhythm is crazy. It just keeps going and going and going, straight lines, curvy lines, all sorts of stuff. One of the things we're going to talk about today is scale and proportion. And I'm going to do a mini show, because I've told you guys you can curate shows based on themes. There's an artist from South America. He's one of my favorite artists named Fernando Botero. He painted a piece, 2001, called Picnic, and I think you can see pretty clear. These are pretty beefy people. That leg looks like that banana, okay? These are just, so it's a sense of exaggerated scale. It's political commentary. He is poking fun at the rich people of his country. We have the same thing in a piece from one of his tango series. It's the exact same idea, the sense of scale and proportion, and that is what it looks like. I have no doubt that they are moving as graceful as anything, but the legs and the shoulders and the arms and everything else, those are the body parts of an NFL fullback. And then finally, the piece that I think I've shown this before, He's having some fun with a famous painting called the Mona Lisa, the Botero version of the Mona Lisa. And I know it looks like the screen is messing up the face, but nope, that's exactly what it looks like. I think it's called Mona Lisa at the age of 14. Massive, massive head, okay? But then look at the little dinky hands. So he's just having a good old time with scale and proportion. So today, principles of design, we're going to look at, we have a slide of the various kinds of design principles that we're going to look at. They include, it's forthcoming, I'll just say them. It's unity and variety, it's balance, it's emphasis and subordination, it's scale and proportion, as we just saw with Botero, and rhythm, which is one of the questions of the day. Okay, so first we're going to talk about unity and variety. And when you talk about that in terms of art, one of the ways that, and the purpose of all this as, who wrote a little while ago? Connor wrote, I believe. It's a way, all these design principles are a way to activate your eye, to keep you engaged with the piece. You move your eye, literally, I mean, your head can move too, but your eyes are just following everything, goes into space, comes out. So the one way that artists do that is through unity and variety. We have a piece, yet again, of Matisse, because he's a very good artist to show in an introduction to art class. It's called Memory of Oceana. And we're not going to look at the content. He's clearly having a flashback, and he's having memories of a trip. What we're talking about is the unity of this simply means you look at the shapes and the forms and everything else. You've got a rectangle, you've got a rectangle, you've got some curvy organic thing, sort of a rectangle, a triangle. So these shapes, they're all related. They balance the painting, which is what we're going to talk about later. So that's one way that you can tie a painting together, is by having a bunch of different kinds of shapes that are reflected and echoed throughout the piece. And then, so it doesn't get visually boring or static, you balance it with all this other stuff. That's one of the things I find the most amazing about looking at art, and in particular with painting, is, and I've asked, I think I've probably asked all the painters I know, how do you do this? Are you thinking about this? Are you thinking about any kind of mathematical formulas or anything? Each and every one of them said, nope, it's just intuitive. So they don't know what they're doing. And then you look back and you go, wow, look at all that stuff going on in there. We have an image by Jackson Pollock, to continue unity and variety, called Shimmering Substance. And as I've mentioned before, Jackson Pollock, he revolutionized painting. He didn't paint it, this thing, on an easel. He didn't necessarily paint it with a brush in the sense that we know. He stood over it, this massive canvas, which is on the floor. He dripped paint on it. He dripped paint from the can, from a jar, from a brush. He splattered it, which is with a brush. He dripped it, and that's why this kind of painting is also called drip painting. But in terms of unity and variety, this entire surface, I mean, there's nothing recognizable in it, but it's like not a grid, it's like kind of a spider web sort of thing going on, because you can see all these yellow shapes, and you get the order of how we did it. Yellow came last. So you've got the yellow little splash things right there, and they go out like that. But then you've also got the bigger pictures like that. So everything overall, and this is actually called an all over, another name for this kind of abstract expressionist art is called all over painting. So you have this all-over unity just by how dense and actually how architectural all of that is. But you have, it's made up. of just a bunch of variety, these little swirls and these dabs of paint and all of that stuff. That's a very good example of that. We have an image, well, it's kind of a three-dimensional piece by an artist named Annette Massager called Mes Voix. It's called My Voices, and it's an installation, it's hanging. Okay, so everything's hanging. But the fact is, overall, the unity of this thing, the macro level of it, is it's this big semi-oval thing. It looks like a blimp. But the fact is, it's made up of entirely of laid over images of all sorts of stuff. We're not going to talk about the content. We're just talking about this in terms of the idea of unity and variety. And finally, there's an artist, one of my favorite guys, artist of all time, Joseph Cornell. They call him a surrealist artist, but he didn't belong to anything per se. He just made boxes. I mean, this is a box. It's a box, just like that. So within the box, he's got, you know, the rods, and you can, if you tilt it, that ball is gonna roll back and forth. He's got a box with some kind of hypnotic thing. He's got a box, or better yet, a frame, we can call it. A frame of a bird, a little piece of paper with writing. It's all tied together by this, which is echoed by the rectangle shape, which is echoed in these box shapes. But then within each one, there's all sorts of little activity going on. And I think it's fantastic. To get a really good sense of Cornell, because I think he doesn't get talked about much anymore, but I think I just love him and his work. We're going to look at a brief, it's about a 2-minute, I think, video right now, and then we'll get back and talk about balance. Thank you. Objects in those boxes. It's sculpture, it's painting, it's collage, it's fantastic. But for our purposes, it's an excellent example of unity and variety in art. We have a response to the how do we use design in our daily lives from Kristen. And I actually, when I read it, I had to start laughing because it's totally true, and I never have thought about that until she actually brings this up. Kristen, thank you. I use principles of design subconsciously, and get this, when I drive. I am able to determine the distance of another car and movement of other vehicles from my perception of space and motion. These give me cues to know when I need to brake and be aware of other drivers. You know, I never would have put it into words because I do it so subconsciously, but I'm there with you, Kristen. When I drive, especially in traffic, it's like looking at a sculpture, a three-dimensional grid, and it's moving and it's unpredictable, and you've got to have all the pieces in play, and there is a rhythm. Lanes go ahead of you, lanes slow down, you pass and everything. That's a very, very, very good answer. Thank you. We'll do one more rhythm. Hello, Katrina. I think visual rhythm helps set the pace for the piece in terms of the viewer's reaction. very good word for talking about rhythm in art, pace. A viewer may have an energetic and joyful reaction when looking at the rhythm of the circus by George Seurat, for example. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. You can almost hear the calliope going da 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 da. I mean, it's rhythm. That's why I chose that piece. Thank you. Very good. We're going to talk about balance. Now, when you, all these things that we're talking about, I mean, unity and variety, these are all common sense things that you know about. In fact, Katrina writing about rhythm and driving, it's, we're aware of it. There's no, you know, these are not art historical terms. These are things that we deal with in our daily life. So when you talk about balance, it's exactly what it is, and it's not going to work. Oh, look, it works. Balance. We're going to look at some examples of balance. There's an artist in, he did a very famous piece here in South Coast Plaza, but he did a piece in New York. It's called, his name is Izumo Noguchi. He did a piece called The Red Cube. Now, you might think this thing is as big as, oh, I don't know, a cube of sugar or something, but it's not. It's actually massive. It weighs tons, and it comes to a little dinky point right there. And besides the fact that it's red and that has all sorts of symbolic meanings, it's a point. You can't really see it, but it's a point. It's an amazing piece of balance. It's not going to topple that way. Not going to talk, well, you pray it doesn't, and it's not going to come at us this way. So anyway, very good example of that. To see this thing in motion, we're going to now look again at a quick video of it. It's like 2 minutes long, and it'll give you a sense of what it actually looks like in real space and time. As far as I can tell, this was taken off a cell phone. The noise is kind of weird. If you can actually mute the sound when we play it, but otherwise, just enjoy and have a look at this. It gives you a sense of the scale. First of all, it would demolish those cars if it fell backwards. But I really like that video because here this crazy thing is on a point, but you look behind it and there's this massive building. So the building is like a pyramid, kind of. I mean, yeah. So the building, you know, it's one of those, oh, it's not going to work. You know, it's stable, it's flat, it goes up and up, it's a skyscraper, stable. This is the exact opposite. It's unstable, and yet it's got a precarious balance. You can bring whatever themes into it. When I see that and works like that, I think that it's a metaphor for life. We're all precariously balanced, and then God knows what's going to happen after that. Anyway. So we have two kinds of balance. We have symmetrical balance. We have an image by Haruka Kojin called Reflect 2. And we'll just go through these quickly. Yeah, it's color. Yeah, it's all that stuff. But it's symmetrical balance. I don't know when I started to do this. When I look at anything, an installation like this, a sculpture, a painting, a drawing, I play the teeter-totter game. I mentally put a teeter-totter right there and I say, is it going to go that way? Is it going to go that way? Well, this is a symmetrical, balanced piece. So whatever you get out of the colors and the shapes and everything, it is symmetrical. One of the implications of that is it's balanced, it's stable, it's not going anywhere. Another example, and you guys, I bet have know of Georgia O'Keeffe without maybe knowing anything about her. Very famous image It's a deer skull, but again, teeter totter, donk. It's not going anywhere. It is perfectly poised. It's timeless. It's monumental. But it shows what happens over time. The flesh from the deer goes away, gets bleached away, and you've got that skull. We've got an image by a bunch of artists called the Newer Artist. It's at a monastery in central Tibet. Again, all that information, but let's do the teeter-totter. I mean, you can obviously do it however you do it. It looks massive. It looks all sorts of everything. All this movement, but it's not going anywhere, literally or figuratively. Now you have what's called asymmetrical balance. We have an image by Gustav Klimt called Life and Death. And as you might imagine, symmetrical balance means you got teeter-totter. Well, when you talk about an image, and you can talk about the balance of it in terms of, you know, what's the size and the scale, but you can also talk about something in terms of weight. So when you look at a bunch of, like, just pretend these are not bodies for a second. This is life, that's death. Okay, these bodies are brightly colored, okay? I mean, obviously in comparison to Mr. Death with his scythe. But what you have to, and even though it takes up more space, this shape of life versus that shape of death, the point being, conceivably, this has got more visual balance. It's asymmetrical because symbolically, we would consider black or a darker color like dark blue or whatever to be heavier visually, okay? Nothing complex there. If you look at something bright, it's going to be breezy. It's like, you know, bright clothes blowing on a clothesline. When you look at something like this, it looks like a rock or a dead tree or something. And again, even though the shape is bigger, this one has more visual weight to it. It's asymmetrical for that reason. Another piece is it's Nanomura. It's the Zen priest Choka. Again, it's ancient Asian art. But the point being that it's a good example of asymmetrical balance, and this one more apparent than the other one. This versus this. You do a teeter-totter, and it's just going to topple over that way. And the point being, this is a void, in other words. And there, I'm sure there's philosophical reasons for it. But visually, this has more weight to it. Okay, it's darker. It's got shapes. It's got some kind of movement and rhythm going on. It's got more visual weight. Therefore, it's going to tip the visual balance that way. And it's going to get our eyes to focus on that image. We're going to look at a picture by J.M.W. Turner, The Burning of the Houses of Parliament. Exact same thing. Again, you do it like that. You would think that because this is a lighter color, and I mean, it's made out of stone or brick or masonry, it's going to be heavier. And this is more, it's brighter, it's not a solid. It's not a solid shape. It's more gassy, more the plumes of smoke and everything. But in terms of visual balance, I think it tips over that way, because even though linear-wise, that's going up that way. It's got more visual weight. There's more activity. And again, it's just a way that the artist will get your eyes to move and to look at something like that. And then finally, this is by Edouard Manet, Impressionist. It's called A Bar at the Folie Bergère. This was one of the copies of this was actually in the gallery at my graduate school. You look at this, and I mean, it seems like it's perfectly balanced, but as a matter of fact, it isn't, because you've got the colors there. It's a little bit darker there. It seems symmetrical, but it seems heavier over there. And one of the reasons that the artist gets you to do that, you can't see it, but this is a mirror. And in the mirror, there's what is allegedly a portrait of the artist, self-portrait, and he's looking at her, looking at him. So he's trying to get your eye to move and look at that. Balance. It's symmetrical, which generally means something is stable or enduring, or it's asymmetrical. It's not balanced. It's about to topple. It's got more imminence to it, more like an imminent threat or something. We're going to look at one more set here called Emphasis and Subordination, and then we're going to take a break. Okay, we have an image by Henry Asawa Tanner called The Banjo Lesson. When you talk about emphasis and subordination, again, in terms of utter common sense, the artist is just trying to get our eyes to look at something. Here, he or she will do it by emphasizing on one thing and de-emphasizing or subordinating the other thing. Well, it's pretty clear what he's trying to do. The kid has got more light on his face. The banjo is white. Other things are white in this piece, but the banjo is especially vivid because it's against either the shadow or the vest of the guy playing the, teaching his whoever, grandson or son, to play the banjo. Another example of that is a still life by Paul Cézanne called, Still Life with Compotier, Pitcher, and Fruit. We saw a Mona Lisa, we saw a Madonna and Child last week, and it was a triangle like that. Well, you know, these are nicely rendered fruit and a vase and everything. It's got a triangle, but if you notice, it's seen at an angle, so the thing is toppling over or falling down. What he's doing is he's emphasizing the fruit and de-emphasizing the background. And again, yes, this is all painfully obvious, but he does it with colors, light versus dark. He does it with this geometric shape versus the shapelessness of the drapes behind. Simple point, but nonetheless important point. Then we have a painting by Francisco de Goya. It's called The Executions of the 3rd of May, 1808. Now, the title, I'm going to clarify it a little bit for you, is actually Executions of the 3rd of May, 1808. What happened took place in 1808. The piece was painted in 1812, but I was worried that if I put a comma after 1808, you would see the 1812 and you would go, wait, what? Anyway, again, very simple point. It's a political piece. The theme is political and it's social history. But for our intents and purposes, in terms of emphasis and subordination, we got the guy in vivid white, who stands out in stark contrast to the anonymity, because we don't see the faces of these guys, the darks of the clothes, the dark of the sky, and the relative darkness of everything else around him. So that's him right there, emphasis and subordination. And we're going to look at a brief video of Goya, of this piece, because I think it's this guy's description is really good, but I think it's important to get a really good look at the image. So we're going to watch the video, and then we're going to cut directly to a 5-minute break after the video. So enjoy the video, and we'll see you back shortly.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining me for another edition of Painting of the Week. And this week, we're going to be talking about Francisco de Goya's 3rd of May. I think this is a pretty familiar painting. This was painted in 1814, and the scene that is depicted here, we're commemorating the Spanish resistance to the invasion of Napoleon's troops, which occurred in 1808. That was part of the Peninsular War, one of the many Napoleonic wars that occurred in Europe during the early 19th century. And the kind of art historian catchphrase that is usually linked with this painting is that it's perhaps the first modern revolution painting. And we've looked at other paintings where revolution has been a theme. Eugène Delacroix's Liberty Leading the People jumps to mind, the French Revolution. So Goya, of course, being Spanish, there's going to be a clear bias in this painting, which is obviously that the Spanish are the victims and the French are the aggressors. The way that we can immediately kind of establish that dynamic is based on the fact, I think, we cannot see the faces of any of the French soldiers, whereas the faces of the Spanish, the patriots, are very clear to the viewer, and we can definitely associate some emotion with the types of expressions that we see here. So as a viewer, I'm thinking, okay, I can immediately sympathize with the emotion that I see in the Spanish, whereas the French are kind of like these machines. They don't have any facial expressions that are visible to me as the viewer, and I don't really form any sort of intimate connection or understanding of them. And in speaking of machines, the geometry, I think, of these soldiers is very important here. The gun and their bodies form this kind of repeated angle that we see that follows along this line of soldiers, and they're all in this very straight line. It's very rectilinear, very ordered. So let's talk more about this central figure. He has his arms raised above his head. He's on his knees as if he's, almost begging. And this pose, I think, is very interesting. This is something that's definitely been discussed before by other art historians, is that this pose is kind of reminiscent of a crucifix, the way the hands are extended above the head. And if you look closely, this might be difficult to see, we can also see evidence of a stigmata or a stigma. While I think it's definitely safe to say that Goya is playing with a sort of religious motif here, I don't think you want to overemphasize that too much, because there's other indications in the sort of ambiance of this painting that kind of lead us in other directions, and I'll talk about that a little bit later on. Kind of continuing along that same sort of religious theme, we can see some individuals here have their hands folded in prayer. This person is probably, based on that really attractive haircut, he's probably a monk. We have this light lantern type thing here on the ground, and you can see that the way that the light is emitted, it's illuminating the Spanish. So it's kind of like they're on a stage or something here. And we have this kind of interesting geological artifact here. I'm not exactly sure what this is supposed to be, but there's some kind of mound of like dirt or a wall here, which gives the impression that the Spanish they're boxed in. They're completely trapped. There's no way that they can escape. And then another thing just briefly that I feel like I have to mention is that the color of the central figure's yellow pants there, along with the blood that we see on the ground, is also reminiscent of the Spanish flag. So once again, reinforcing that theme of patriotism. I want to wrap this up by talking a little bit more about how Goya is really breaking with tradition here. And that's in the sense that the men here, these Spanish resistors, are not really depicted as heroes like we would traditionally think of in a history painting that's commemorating some sort of, event in which men of virtue demonstrated their heroism. These men are kind of depicted almost as kind of cowardly. And the central figure here is no one person in particular. There's a very kind of anonymous sense of the violence here, and this aura of martyrdom is absent. And that's why I said I don't really think that the whole Christ-like association that we can draw from the position of that main central figure's body is something we want to push too much, because we don't get the sense that we do in those medieval religious paintings of a martyr here as much as we do just someone who was kind of in the wrong place at the wrong time. So the viewer ends up really lacking that sort of catharsis or the sense of loss that we can get that we usually associate with the death of a truly virtuous person. So I get the sense that Goya is trying to explore here, maybe for the first time, the sort of anonymity of violence that is associated with battle or with the casualties of war. So next time we come in here, next week, we're going to look at a very similar painting by Manet, similar in terms of both theme and artistic style, that was inspired by Goya's Third of May. And we'll kind of compare and contrast. So we'll see you next week.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The certificate program in social media strategies and content marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
My name is Danaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
One of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what Hux 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is the advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities? I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, both of our anecdotes are about, you know, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
The benefits of this model involves the faculty, because we can be closer to one another, and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The thematic approach and building through a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future Hux students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized, because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the terms, the five terms of this program.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, folks. Welcome back. I really like that video that we just saw on that Goya painting, because what he very effectively did is he took a walk. I mean, he was talking, you know, about the, as he said, the anonymity of the soldiers shooting the guy. So everything's black, the black hats, everything dark, as I'd said before, versus the very clear white. Nothing is more stark than the contrast of black and white. And so he did a good discussion of it in terms of the formal qualities. But what he also did, and for purposes of our Let's Take a Walks, he also talked about the social and political aspects of it, and he brought it all together. I believe his expression was the anonymity of war, and which you can see in the formal qualities of the piece. And that's a good balance. That's a good way to be looking at art. And that's a way that I would encourage you to do it, is to get a sense of what's happening in the piece, the theme, via the theme that the piece is telling or narrating, and then looking at various components. So it tells a story about this particular incident in history, by means of the contrast of the colors and the emphasis and subordination of the shapes via the colors. It's just, all in all, it's a good way to look at stuff, because it's not academic. It's just, again, I think this is the most commonsensical discussion that we have this term, because everything you already have in your head, you just have to think, oh yeah, that, and just apply it. So there you go. I'm going to read a couple more responses. Brandon is writing. Brandon, thank you. The visual elements in our everyday life aren't something we think of. It was interesting to read about the dwelling in the Fun Chun Mountains painting, because it is a landscape painting. Is there more to that? Is there more to Brandon's... because it is, okay, well, that was truncated. I apologize, Brandon. But no, it's something you don't necessarily think about every day, because what happens is you're living something, or you're experiencing something, and you're, unless you're a cyborg or something, or a Terminator, you're probably not consciously processing everything that you're looking at. And so one of the functions of art, as we talked about in the first lecture, is to make you aware of art, which A, is everywhere, but B, is also accessible just by spending some time looking at it. A couple more responses here. We have Gracie, who writes, thank you. I think artists create rhythm in pieces in order to create a sense of interaction with the viewer. That is essentially the most significant thing about all these things we've done last week and this week. The artists, they're expressing stuff. I mean, it's kind of hard to talk about expression in this kind of a format, because art can mean anything. Artists can be expressing anything. What they're trying to express might not be what we are inferring that they're expressing, or what we think the piece means. But what it does nonetheless is rhythm, for instance, does indeed create an interaction with the viewer. It engages us in the piece. And again, that's what the class is about. It's learning or relearning to engage with art on a non-intellectual level. It's just taking common sense, taking your eyes, taking your life experiences, your beliefs, your cultural values, and just looking. Okay, Katie writes, thanks Katie, for the first question, do you use design in your life? For the first question, one way I use design in my life without really knowing it is when I write. For most of my classes, I write notes during class and I make sure that they're all understandable after class is over for studying. If they're understandable, if you mean organized, yeah. My writing style, being different from everyone else's, has different technique. So you handwrite, wow. Has different technique and slant that follows a certain design throughout all my writings in notes, journals, etc. That's great, and that, you know, I would discuss that all the time because, but people don't write anymore. And I think you can tell a lot about somebody's character. Just like we want to choose a president via the Artorial College, just by looking at a self-portrait. It's really interesting. Okay, she writes in the second question, just as you asked about in a previous lecture, artists may or may not force their own beliefs onto their work. One reason I believe artists use visual rhythm is not only to captivate the viewer, or even sometimes to display how you would imagine sound through shapes and colors, but to possibly get the viewers to think about what the artist might or might not have forced into the art. Yeah. Likewise, they could also use rhythm to emphasize something that could be happening during their time, such as political events or religious things, and the viewer may be seeing those things through the rhythm of the piece. That's fascinating. The first part of it is fascinating because you handwrite and you're aware of the design of your handwriting. It can also be called the calligraphy. To actually add to that, that's a great two great responses. One of my favorite authors is a British woman named Virginia Woolf. And she has this amazing quote because I read it when I was in high school and it's been one of my favorite quotes and probably one of the most influential quotes that I've applied to my writing. And this is grossly paraphrasing the eloquent Virginia Woolf, but she said something to the effect of, rhythm is everything. If you don't have rhythm, you can't write. You can be staggeringly brilliant. You can have all sorts of insight, but if you don't have rhythm, you can't write, plain and simple. So it's the idea in writing too, and rhythm is what you can hear. It's the sound of the words and the sentences and the phrasing. And so when you read somebody, like for instance, Virginia Woolf, the rhythm picks up, it slows down. It corresponds to what she's feeling. Her heart is beating fast. She's going to sleep, whatever. Alexis writes about rhythm. Thank you. Rhythm in art is one of the most important elements required for constructing a captivating composition that would seize the observer's eyes excuse me, and would proceed to move the eye in and around all the parts of the artwork. Yeah, exactly. It's, again, she's picking up with one of your prior responses was that it engages the eye. Rhythm, as we saw with the Seurat piece, it gets your eye engaged, it gets you moving, it keeps you moving, your eye moving around the piece. The more time you spend looking at it, the more time that you're going to get insight into it, that it's going to relate to your life, that you're going to make it your own. It's going to become your own personal painting. Philip, again, Philip from Orange, hello. Philip's writing this time. Phillips says, "I think artists create rhythm because it's something that has always been done in dance, music, and art. Mm-hmm. They incorporate rhythmical elements in their works because people like repetition and hearing and seeing the same thing over and over again." True, and I think people like repetition because if you didn't have repetition in something like dance, you'd have chaos. So rhythm also brings order to art and dance. He continues, "It makes viewers feel good or relaxed because it's something that they've seen or heard before. I definitely notice this when I'm listening to other musicians or playing a gig myself. Now I understand how that is used in art." Thank you. Very observant. And furthermore, when we get into our oh-so-brief discussion of modern art in the penultimate class, which is the week of Thanksgiving, we're going to see how when abstract art came along, a lot of the artists who were the innovators, there wasn't one inventor of abstract art. It came all at once from different sources. Some of the most prominent ones, including Vasily Kandinsky, who we saw, Russian guy, lawyer of all things, he was also an avid musician, and a lot of his compositions are named in a musical vein. Okay, we're going to do one more. Connor, again, is writing. Thank you. "I use color and design." This is the first question of the day. "I use color and design in a daily basis when I draw. I don't want to put two colors together that don't go well together. I make sure the colors match in my drawings." Yeah, so he doesn't say, thanks, that's true. He doesn't say whether he's conscious of, by the way, Connor, if you're an artist, go to the forum. We have a forum called Look What I've Done, Look What I've Seen. Please post something. But yeah, that's true. He doesn't state whether he does that consciously while he's doing it or unconsciously, or only sees it afterwards. But yeah, there's a sense that everything has to come together. Okay, we got to do a couple more things here. We're going to talk about scale and proportion. Scale and proportion is what we looked at when we saw the Botero pieces, my little mini lecture of the we'll call them abundantly scaled couple dancing a tango, having a picnic, and for all we know, being the parents of the equally abundantly scaled Mona Lisa. We have two artists, Klaus Oldenburg and Kusi van Bruggen, pop artists is what they were, actually, called Plantois. It's actually a, we used to call them a digger. I think we call them a spade. Now you might think, well, that's just a close-up or something against, photoshopped against a landscape, and that the tree is smaller because it's in the back. But no, in point of fact, this thing is beyond life size. It's massive. It's conceivably as big, if not bigger, than the trees. It's kind of funny. It might even be an ironic statement, how a gardening tool can actually be bigger than the thing that it is supposedly gardening. We have a video, which we're not going to have time for, of another piece by Klaus Oldenburg. It's he did a piece at the Whitney called Giant BLT. And as you saw from the prior piece that we're looking at behind me, a BLT, yes, bacon, lettuce, and tomato. It is massive, beyond life size. Instead, we're going to look at an image by the Belgian surrealist René Magritte called Delusions of Grandeur Number 2. And again, scale and proportion is, we're just talking about how different parts of the same thing can be bigger relative to each other. You can see how it was in the prior image. Something that is typically much smaller is shown to be much bigger. This is bronze. It's a portrait. It's a portrait. No head, no arms, like the Mona. It's like the Venus de Milo that's in marble. Well, obviously, the woman's hips or her waist is huge. The hips are smaller and the torso is even smaller. That can have all sorts of meaning. But it's just an example of how artists can use scale and proportion to say various things about their work. We have an image of the stela of the sculptor Yuzhewo. It's ancient, it's Asian, but the fact is it's scale that we're talking about. There's interesting, there's the sun and the sun's rays, but nope, we're not looking at that. We're looking at the unusually distinct difference in scale between the stick figure kids and the massive people right there. Of course, the parents are going to be larger than the kids. This is taking it to an unusual extreme, and there is symbolism in there. We are going to look at an image from Benin in Africa called A Royal Altar to the Hand. And again, it's just emphasis and subordination. The hand, the size of the hands here for various purposes are massive. They are almost as big as the heads themselves. And the symbolism of that is explained quite clearly in that image. We have an image of something drawn by Leonardo da Vinci, the study of human proportions according to Vitruvius. And in the Renaissance, when art became very mathematical and very precise, very realistic and true to life, they actually thought out the proportions for human beings. And this is based on Vitruvius, who was from an ancient philosopher and mathematician. The key point here is you've got a basic human figure. You can see his limbs, right? But everything's got to be in proportion. So if the arms are one length, the legs are a certain length in relation to the torso, in relation to the arms. And in a lot of the artists of that era, especially with Da Vinci, because he left so many drawings, that is indeed the case. There was this idea of ideal beauty. And so we can talk about scale and proportion in terms of the exaggeration that we've seen in the last couple of images, but we can also talk about it how perfect that artist would try to make it. Let's see, we're gonna talk about rhythm real quick, and then I'm gonna try to get to these questions here. Rhythm is exactly what we've been talking about all along. It's the repetition of things that creates a sense of predictability, just like we saw that massive cube by Noguchi on a little point. It's unpredictable, it's unstable. We can look at rhythm. There's an artist, and her name is Maya Lin. Maya Lin, at the age of 22, did something absolutely extraordinary. She was in graduate school at Yale. There was a competition in, I believe, 1982 to design the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Massive undertaking, massive international competition. And everybody on earth applied for it. Well, guess who won it? This early 20s grad student. And it's the simplicity of it is just unbelievable. The names of all the dead are written here. Okay, and it same goes that way. It's like an arrowhead or some kind of a flying edge. You descend down, but that's not what we're talking about. Maya Lin also did a piece called Storm King Wave Field. And it's a perfect example of rhythm. And what we see, oh, I'm sorry, folks, excuse me. What we see is she's created these, we call them protuberances underground, burial mounds, something ceremonial, yeah. And people are just sitting there overlooking it. But the fact is, it's rhythm. The same shapes are repeated in a line, going that way, you know, up and down. But you can also read it across that way. We can understand it like that. Okay, we're gonna skip the next two, and we're gonna look at some of these, we're gonna answer some of these questions. Sage, hello. There are many ways of using the principles of design in our daily lives. Some people even have their own special ways of using it, like one student had mentioned with their notes. Some other great ways of using principles of design in our daily life, for example, like structuring an email more properly, or maybe for a resume. You know, that's actually, if you guys hear nothing else that I'm saying, learn how to do a resume and design it, because there's a bunch of wrong ways to do it. But anyway, very good, very good. Where are we at here? Structuring an email more properly, or maybe for a resume, letting your boss know you're more responsible or the job you want, understand how clean you can make things look. You know, actually, hygiene is design. I never thought of that. Using the rule of thirds to compose great photographs, yep. And using negative space to effectively decorating your house and maybe your room. Sage, this is all brilliant, and if you could send me an email or something showing me how you use negative space to decorate a bedroom or a living space, I would be fascinated. Thank you. Giving you the most efficient way of using a small space to keep everything you need in it. I think that's what you mean, but negative space, well, anyway, you gotta keep moving on here. Thank you. Illuminating. Kristen, rhythm, thank you. Rhythm creates movement within a piece of art and is able to direct the viewer's eyes where the artist wants them to go. It creates a sort of roadmap for the art. Actually, that is a brilliant way to describe my final point. Everything that ties together everything that we've looked at today is called composition, okay? The way an artist composes any work of art includes all the elements that we've looked at today. And I was actually gonna bring it up right now, and coincidentally, Kristen describes it in a brilliant way. So we're gonna call composition the roadmap for the work of art. Brilliant, and thank you. Emily, I'm afraid I can't get to you, but I'm gonna read them all. You're gonna get credit for them all. Thank you. Next week, we're gonna do drawing and painting. And so we're getting into the materials of art. We're gonna have a video lecture of an artist with an artist that I've known for years and I've done before. Have a good week. Keep up the good work. Take care. Bye.